has taught us the greatness of true humility, and that while he was God and he did serve others, and thus call us to watch with him in passion, give us grace to serve and love one another, and to enter into the fellowship of his sufferings. In his name and for his sake we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid.
Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ said. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who now liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end.
Amen. Amen.
Almighty and everlasting God, who hatest nothing that thou hast made, and dost forgive the sins of all those who are penitent, create and make in us new and contrite hearts, that we, worthily lamenting our sins and acknowledging our wretchedness, may obtain of thee, the God of all mercy, perfect remission and forgiveness through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated for the first lesson.
Here we begin at the 31st verse of the 31st chapter of the book of the prophet Jeremiah. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will make a new covenant in the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was a husband unto them, saith the Lord. But this shall be a covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts, and will write it in their hearts, will be their God, and they shall be my people. And they shall teach no more every man his neighbor, and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them unto the greatest of them, saith the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. Here endeth the Old Testament lesson.
Thanks be to God.
The portion of the Psalter appointed for today is Psalm 116, found on page 486 of the Book of Common Prayer. Let us please stand and recite Psalm 116 responsibly by half verse. My delight is in the Lord.
Because he hath heard the voice of my prayer.
Because he hath inclined his ear unto me.
Therefore will I call upon him as long as I live.
The snares of death compassed me round about.
And the pains of hell had hold upon me.
I found trouble and heaviness. Then called I upon the name of the Lord.
O Lord, I beseech thee, deliver my soul.
Gracious is the Lord, and righteous.
Yea, our God is merciful.
The Lord preserveth the simple.
I was in misery, and he helped me.
Turn again, then, unto thy rest, O my soul.
For the Lord hath rewarded thee.
And blind, thou hast delivered my soul from death.
My eyes from tears, and my feet from falling.
I will walk before the Lord.
In the land of the living.
I believe, and therefore will I speak, but I was sore troubled.
I said in my haste, all men are liars.
What reward shall I give unto the Lord?
For all the benefits that he hath done unto me.
I will receive the cup of salvation.
And call upon the name of the Lord.
I will pay my vows now in the presence of all his people.
Right here in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints.
Behold, O Lord, how that I am thy servant.
I am thy servant, and the son of thy handmaid. Thou hast broken my bonds in sunder.
I will offer to thee the sacrifice of thanksgiving.
And will call upon the name of the Lord.
I will pay my vows unto the Lord in the sight of all his people.
In the courts of the Lord's house, even in the midst of thee, O Jerusalem, praise the Lord.
Thank you.
13th chapter of St. John, beginning at the first verse. Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour was come, that he should depart out of this world unto the Father, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them unto the end. And supper being ended, the devil having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he was come from God and went to God, he riseth from supper, and laid aside his garments, and took a towel, and girded himself. After that he poureth water into a basin, and began to wash the disciples' feet, and to wipe them with the towel wherewith he was girded. Then cometh he to Simon Peter, and Peter saith unto him, Lord, dost thou wash my feet? Jesus answered and said unto him, What I do thou knowest not now, but thou shalt know hereafter. Peter saith unto him, Thou shalt never wash my feet. Jesus answered him, If I wash thee not, thou hast no part with me. Simon Peter saith unto him, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. Jesus saith to him, He that is washed needeth not save to wash his feet, but is clean every whit, and ye are clean, but not all. For he knew who should betray him, therefore said he, You are not all clean. So after he had washed their feet, and had taken his garments, and was set down again, he said unto them, Know ye what I have done to you? Ye call me Master and Lord. Ye say, Well, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and Master, have washed your feet, ye also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example, that ye should do as I have done to you. The Gospel of the Lord.
Thank you.
visitors who are with us this evening. We are glad that you have come, and we pray the Lord will speak to your heart and mind through word and sacrament. Per the bylaws of the parish and the canons of our church, all visitors who are baptized Christians, who love the Lord Jesus Christ in sincerity and truth, are always invited to receive Holy Communion from the altar of this church. We also ask that you would sign our guest book so that we might get to know you better. Directing your attention briefly to the announcements, just a couple of them. Good Friday service tomorrow at noon. There will be an Easter breakfast in Teal Hall, light breakfast fare. Bring your own between the 8 o'clock service, which is a said service, and the 10:30 service, which is music. And I commend the other announcements to you. For those of you who might not have been to Monday and Thursday service before, it's a little different than any of our other worship services. At the conclusion of the Holy Communion, there will be no music for the last part of the service. We ask that you remain in prayer and contemplation as the altar is stripped with the reading of the crucifixion psalm, Psalm 22. When all of that is completed, the clergy will depart in silence, and as we leave, we ask that you also follow in silence. And we will not meet again until tomorrow at noon. If there are no other announcements, the sermon hymn is number 199.
Thank you.
said unto him, Lord, dost thou wash my feet? Jesus answered and said to him, what I am doing you do not understand now, but you will know after this. Peter said to him, you will never wash my feet. And Jesus answered him, if I do not wash you, you have no part with me. Jesus then proceeds to do just that. And he washed all their feet and put on his garments again and sat down with them. He said to them, do you know what I've done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you say, well, here I am. If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example, and you should do as I have done to you. Most assuredly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who sent greater than the one who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do. My dear Holy Week worshipers, my brethren of this parish, and visitors, in his first epistle, St. John wrote, we love him because he first loved us, 1 John 4:19. And in the same epistle, in this, the love of God was manifested towards us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through him. Matthew wrote in Matthew 20, verse 28, Jesus came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. In light of these clear words of Holy Scripture, why then do so many people who claim to be Christians insist that somehow they must themselves do something proactive, something meritorious in order for God to love them? Why do so many people who claim to be Christian insist that their own works must be included in some kind of almost mathematical formula that brings about their forgiveness and salvation? And this is found in various denominations and churches that run from the Catholic to the non-denominational. Why do so many people claim to be Christians absolutely insist that it's by their own declaration of faith or their decision for Jesus that they earned their baptism as an affirmation of the faith that they have extricated, that they have explain that they earned the right to be at the Lord's table on this night and on other times when the Lord's Supper is celebrated, and that they earned the right somehow to receive absolution. The idea that we contribute to our own salvation is one of the most basic and oldest heresies. To think this way, one must fail to understand who Jesus is and what he has in fact done for them. And we see that at the very beginning of the church with the exchange between Jesus and Peter. In our text, Jesus and his disciples are being served a meal. The disciples are gathered in the gracious presence of Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. And notice they are not giving, they are not doing, they are receiving. For it is the Lord's Passover, as outlined in the 12th chapter of Exodus. The Master is not being served, he is serving. For he is the Lamb of God to whom the Passover pointed all those centuries. It is he who is loving his disciples. It is the divine service and the divine one who gives it. And the only begotten Son of God is the one who is doing the serving. When Jesus, then the Master, assumes the position of the lowliest servant slave and proceeds to serve and love his own by washing their feet, we might make the mistake of thinking that this is just about foot washing and therefore something ritualistic to be reenacted, as sometimes religious groups do. And when they
the whole point. The lowest and dirtiest part of the body in Jewish culture, of course, are the feet. This, of course, is not what one would expect from the Lord God Almighty, the only begotten Son of God. And so Peter raises an objection. You shall never wash my feet. We might think, at first glance, this is something laudable on Peter's part. You'll remember that Peter had said this before, not these exact words, but similar ones, when Jesus began to show his disciples he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed, but on the third day he would be raised. Peter replied, "Far be it from you, Lord, this will not happen to you." At that time, in Caesarea Philippi, Jesus replied to Peter, "Get thee behind me, Satan." In other words, what you are saying and the attitude you're displaying is a hindrance to my mission. You are not even on the side of God when you say these things, but you're on the side of men and the prince of darkness. While this time, at the Passover in Jerusalem, Jesus answered them, "If I do not wash you, you have no part in me." That's pretty plain. Again, if I do not wash you, you have no part in me. Peter, like each of us, must put aside all our own pretensions that we can offer anything to God to help purchase or lead to or influence our own salvation in Christ. It is narcissism to believe that. Only Jesus Christ is able singularly to do what is necessary in order for you and for me and for all of humanity to have a part in him. In order for you to be in Christ, you must be washed, not with a towel and a basin in the upper room, but in the blood of Christ, the Lamb of God, to have a part and place in the body of Christ. Jesus, your Lord, must wash you, not you wash him. He must descend in order to cleanse you, for he condescends even to come among us. For you are not able to ascend enough even to wash his feet. Simon Peter, whose sinful heart is sometimes slow to grasp the point, but no one can say his zeal once he gets the picture. When Jesus puts it this way, Peter exclaims, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." But I submit to you, he still really doesn't get it. Truly, the words of Jesus are being fulfilled at that moment in the upper room. "What I am doing, you do not know now, but afterward you will understand." That's in the Revised Standard Version. Think back what occurred on the Mount of Transfigurations. Again, there's nothing new about what's going on in the upper room here. Peter, you recall, had said to Jesus, when they had gone to the Mount and Jesus had met with Moses and Elijah on the mountaintop, Peter said, "Lord, it's well that we are here. If you wish, I will make three booths," that is, tents that were set aside for special times of worship. Here, there were shrines, one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah. In his mind, Jesus was being lifted up to the status of Moses and Elijah, so he thought he was paying Jesus a compliment. The greatest heroes of the Old Testament, and he said, "Jesus, you're on that same level." But while he was still speaking, God corrected things. Scripture says, "Lo, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud said, 'This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him.'" I would imagine that got people's attention. "Listen to him," the Lord said. So when Jesus said, "What I'm doing right now, you don't know, but later you're going to understand," this is a pattern all through the Gospels. Peter's objection, "Lord, you're going to wash my feet," is another way of saying, "Jesus, you have all this backwards. You should be the one who has your feet washed by the lowest person here, so that we can acknowledge your greatness and your glory." consider which one of us is the greatest, so that the one who is the lowest might do the deed. In fact, we know that at one account of the Last Supper, they actually fall into an argument at some point about who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom of God, while the Son of God is sitting at table with them, about to be sacrificed for their sins. Certainly someone other than you, Lord, ought to bow down and wash the filthy, dung-covered, smelly feet of those here, and by extension of all mankind. And then Jesus said to him, "What I'm doing, you do not know now, but afterwards you'll understand." So there's something about this divine service that the disciples won't get until later. And this leads us to believe that this foot washing is actually, therefore, to be seen as a prelude to something else, a precursor to a greater service that will be done for the benefit of God's people and for the life of the world, an even greater sacrifice that will atone for the sins of the world. That is why Jesus also asked them, "Do you know what I've done to you?" We ordinarily think of Maundy Thursday as the institution of the Lord's Supper, the Holy Communion, the Eucharist, and so it is. But the washing of the feet points to something additional that's going on here. Ponder this. Jesus did his foot washing and declared those words during a time when he was assembled with his disciples during the Passover feast. He did and said this when he, as the incarnate Word, was graciously present with his disciples who were all gathered in the place set aside for that purpose. This upper room, therefore, became the sanctuary, the worship space, and the feast was the holy time when God gathers his people in his name and serves them himself. The Passover feast, indeed, had modeled this and had pointed to it, but it was not the thing itself. But this was a place and a time that was much like that in its setting. In fact, it is a similar setting every time we gather for the Holy Communion on Sunday or feast day. When we gather, and we gather around spiritually the incarnate Son of God, along with the Father and the Holy Spirit, and they're graciously present for the cleansing of the souls of all in the church. It's not foot washing, it's soul washing that takes place through word and sacrament. The foot washing is the application of the gospel to the souls of the people and preparation for the Lord's Supper. I got that teaching from Martin Luther. The foot washing takes place, therefore, and is a symbol that points towards Christian baptism, which is not just plain water, but water included in God's command and combined with God's word to be an outward visible sign of an inward spiritual grace. That's how the prayer book puts it. In holy baptism, we are cleansed in Christ. Our sins are washed away. We die to sin and are reborn to righteousness. And we are grafted into the body of the church, and by adoption we are made children of God, and therefore brothers and sisters of Christ. We are his church, and it is for the washing of rebirth and renewal of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Christ our Savior. And this is accomplished through the love of God and not something we earn. As I've said before, the great German reformer Martin Luther wrote, reminding us the only thing we contribute to our own salvation is that we bring our own sinfulness. When we enter into the presence of Almighty God in humility and repentance and are baptized, it is very much like the foot washing in our gospel. For it is by faith we are saved and not by works. And we receive this washing of personal forgiveness announced to others and to ourselves through the work of Jesus Christ. In our liturgy, following the confession of sins, we hear the holy absolution of the Lord, the actual deliverance of God's forgiveness in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. That is what Christ accomplished on the cross for our sins through his suffering and death. A suffering and death that we should have endured and that we certainly deserve, for the wages of sin is death. This word of absolution, of course, is announced by are somehow more holy, but because they've been given the task. For none of us are worthy. John Calvin said the minister can be identified as one poor beggar telling other poor beggars where to find food. Listen to the beautiful words of absolution from our own Book of Common Prayer in the daily office of morning, noon, and prayer. Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desireth not the death of the sinner, but rather he may turn from his wickedness and live, hath given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce his people being penitent, the absolution or remission of sins. He, meaning Christ, not the minister, pardoneth and absolveth all those who truly repent and unfailingly believe his holy gospel. Wherefore, let us beseech to grant us true repentance, that his Holy Spirit, those things may please him which we do at this present, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that the last we may come to his eternal joy through Jesus Christ our Lord. That's what this is all about. This declaration is announced and delivered with the same certainty as when Jesus declared the absolution in the upper room, and when he said to Peter, "You are clean." This proclamation of the forgiveness of sins, which cleansed the soul, was in preparation for the feast that followed. For when the Lord Jesus took the unleavened bread of the Passover and the cup of blessing, he instituted for us a new Passover, which we call the Holy Communion. The bread is the body of Christ, the Passover lamb, which is taken and eaten spiritually, which his disciples are to take and eat, as do we. This is Jesus, whose very body would be and was crucified for our sins. The wine in the cup is the blood of Christ, which his disciples are to take and drink. This is the body and blood of Christ that, through this holy mystery, we receive the benefit of his death. When he took your sins and my sins upon himself, that we might have forgiveness of sins. Once again, the foot washing takes place through word and sacrament. And the foot washing is an application of the gospel to the souls of the faithful in preparation for the Lord's Supper. Just as our baptism precedes our own admittance to the table. It is in anticipation in these sacraments of the church of the wedding banquet of the Lamb and the incarnate Son of God, the marriage supper of the Lamb and his kingdom, which shall have no end, and to which we will one day partake. This time, my fellow friends, this is what it means when we say Christ has purchased our redemption. It is what Jesus has done and continues to do for you. He loved his own who were in the world, and he loved them to the end. And Peter said, "Thou shalt never wash my feet." And Jesus said, "If I don't wash you, you have no part in me." Let us rejoice that God loved us enough to send his only begotten Son to die for our sins, and that all who come to him and believe on his name shall have everlasting life. In the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
That you forget your works and labor that proceed of love, which love ye have shown for his name's sake, who have ministered to the saints and yet do minister. At this time, let us remember the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, how he said it is more blessed to give than receive, as we bring in his tithes and our offering.
Thank you.
who by thy holy apostle has taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, we humbly beseech thee and most to mercifully accept our alms and oblations and to receive these our prayers which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord. And grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. We beseech thee also so to direct and dispose the hearts of all Christian rulers that they may truly and impartially administer justice to the punishment of wickedness and vice and to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers that they may, both by their life and doctrine, set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people, give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence, they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. We also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, beseeching thee to grant them continual growth in thy love and service, and to give us graces to follow their good examples, that with them we may be protectors of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant this, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate. Amen.
Amen.